Future-proofing is a very interesting word, right? It actually stems from removing obsolescence, right? So when you look at technology, technology becomes obsolete very quickly. And where it becomes obsolete very quickly is in the consumer space. So if you look at us as consumers, these days we buy our products and services from e-commerce portals like Amazon. Amazon has been running its business for more than two decades, and the technology that runs Amazon business almost 13 years ago came out as Amazon Web Services, which is the cloud technology that powers the Amazon business. So future-proofing is really about the services that Amazon has used to deliver consumer-related applications and products like Amazon Prime, Alexa, the e-commerce presence, recommendation technology, personalization technology, and so on, available to millions of our active customers world over for the AWS cloud as AWS products and services. And if you think about how public institutions are able to future-proof citizen services using these capabilities, there are a few things which come to mind. One is they're able to very quickly experiment. So the more experiments you're able to run, and at lower cost and at lower risk, the better it is for innovation, right? The second important aspect of future-proofing is the fact that innovating these services is no longer the responsibility of the end user or the end customer. AWS is doing that on behalf of our customers with the pace of innovation of almost, you know, 1,000 plus services and features that we launch every year. And the third aspect of future-proofing is really about the community of partners, technology, as well as the educational community that's built around this. So we have tens of thousands of partners world over who help our customers. We also have a program called AWS Educate, where we're able to provide cloud credits and digital learning for students in India to actually be the next generation technology entrepreneurs and digitalists. Again, if you look at a typical public institution, they have a number of projects going on at the same time. And there are mandates around Digital India. There are mandates around e-governance, which they need to fulfill within a relatively short span of time. You know, we are seeing the cycle of innovation even within public institutions becoming smaller and smaller. So one of the ways that they benefit from the space of innovation that I spoke about, which AWS offers, is they're able to very quickly choose what services are relevant or what technologies are relevant for that particular project. And my team actually helps in what we call well architecting for the cloud, these public institution workloads or applications. And what that actually translates into is looking at the traditional way of software engineering and building applications on physical hardware or on virtualized hardware, and then translating that to hyperscale cloud in the form of services that you can use, you can plug and play, but also in the form of non-functional requirements typically that these applications have. So things like scalability, things like redundancy, things like durability of the data, security, which is paramount. So taking care of all these non-functional requirements very easily and passing on the burden of what we call undifferentiated heavy lifting, which goes behind these applications. So things like managing servers, managing operating system patches, managing the perimeter security of your data center, all of that passed on to AWS to manage on behalf of our customers. So the trends are pretty clear. I think we hear a lot of big data. We have started hearing a lot of open data as well. Open data is very important because when you look at one of the most hyped and talked about and also useful trends, as you can see in the commercial sector, which is machine learning and AI, It relies on a lot of data for training these machine learning and AI models, right? And a lot of this data is not necessarily available within the public institutions. So for instance, if you look at, let's say, transforming agriculture within India and really helping the farmer in terms of identifying, let's say, or predicting disease to a crop and being able to take preventive measures. Now to enable that, think about the kind of data that you need. You need data which will be spatial data in terms of location of where the farm is or where the agricultural land is. You will probably need satellite imagery to take snapshots of that particular farmland at different points of time. You will need weather data and so on and so forth. Now, a lot of these data sets, it's not possible for one public institution to produce on their own. So you would have to rely on open data sets produced by other agencies, and then bringing all of that together across a fairly complex machine learning data science pipeline of tools. So where AWS helps our customers and public institutions in terms of matching this pace of innovation is we make it very easy to, first of all, get access to these open data sets. We have more than 10 petabytes of open data sets available on AWS's registry of open data. We make it very easy for public institutions to publish open data sets. In fact, I welcome public institutions in India to create India-specific open data sets, which will actually solve problems for India. And then finally, where we help is we abstract the complexity in the technology and the pipeline of tools which are necessary for doing really production strength machine learning and AI applications through AWS services.